No? Okay, good. Awesome. Good morning, everybody. Awesome. It's awesome to be here with you guys. I am Mr. Paskey. I actually went to Eastside for a while. I grew up and went from preschool to eighth grade here. I am an eighth grade teacher all the way up near La Crosse, not in Alaska. So I'm currently an eighth grade teacher training to be a principal, and it's awesome to lead you guys in worship here today. So we're going to start in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we're going to start our morning chapel with our opening hymn. Awesome. Let's begin our morning with a responsive reading. God our Father, each day is a gift of your grace. Your mercies are new every morning. Guide our steps by the light of your word. Shield us from harm and keep us from evil. Better than life is your love. Put joy in our hearts and praise on our lips. Let us pray. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power and grant that this day we neither fall into sin nor run into any kind of danger. And in all we do, direct us to what is right in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Awesome. We will continue with our next song. Awesome. Next, we will continue with our verse of the day from Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 to 20. It says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all the instructions I have given you. And surely, I am with you always to the very end of the age." Our lesson today focuses on things are not always as they seem. And I kind of want to start this chapel off with a question, okay? So I need you to think for a second. Use all your brain power. Visualize it in your mind. Get your answer and hold it in your brain, okay? So how many of you like to serve others? Oh, think about it. And I'm sure many of you are thinking, oh, I'd love to serve others. It's my favorite thing to do, and I'm so happy to hear you. I know your thoughts. I know exactly that's what you're thinking. If you're like me, though, sometimes I'm not always super eager to serve others, but I could use some ideas. So, what are some things that you do to serve others? What is something that you could do to serve others? Yeah. Yeah, if someone asks you to do something, you listen and you do it very happily. Yeah. Oh, even if they don't ask you, doing something that you know they would like, that would be a great way of serving others for sure. Yeah. Putting the silverware away. Yes, you have a great one. That is awesome. There's lots of different ways that we could think to serve others. And maybe you think of doing the laundry. That's your favorite thing to do. You could serve others by doing the laundry. You could put away the silverware and the dishes when dinner is done. You could help wash those dishes. You could be there to mow the lawn when it's time to mow the lawn. You could be there to help your brother or your sister with homework if they have a question and you know the answer. You could be there to help them with that. But I know that I'm not always eager to help others. I'm not always ready, right there, ready to go, ready to serve others. And if you ask my siblings, I think they would tell you the same thing. Because I went to Eastside from preschool to eighth grade, and all my siblings went to Eastside from preschool to eighth grade, and one is currently still here. He's hiding in fifth grade back there. That's okay. I'll let him hide for a little bit. If you ask all my siblings, they probably wouldn't tell you that we were super eager to help each other growing up. We liked each other a lot, but we weren't always the nicest or the eagerest. You can kind of see a picture of my siblings up there. You might recognize a couple of their faces. But if you ask them what it was like growing up, they might say, oh, we got into some fights. We got into some arguments. Sometimes we play games that were a little too rough, and instead of stopping when someone got hurt, we were like, oh, let's keep going. Oh, that's okay. We weren't always eager to serve one another because I realized, looking back, we were all trying to be the leader. Now, I'm in the middle. I'm in the blue suit here. I thought I should be the leader because I was the oldest, and I thought I was the wisest, and I thought I was the smartest. Therefore, I should be the leader. Cameron, who's right to, for you guys, to the right, he thought he should be the leader because he was the tallest. He was the strongest. And he thought because you're big and tall, you should be the leader. Or Carly, who's way on the left, or way on the right, she thought she should be the leader because girls know best. And all of her brothers, they would benefit from her wisdom of being a girl. We all thought that we should be the leader, and we all thought that our gifts would serve us best because we would make the best leaders. But it kind of worked out that we ended up kind of just butting heads quite a bit of the time. No, what we're going to look at today in our lesson is that leadership is not always what we think it is, but God, when he looks at leaders, he has a different set of criteria. He looks at different things. So we're going to consider two leaders here today. Our first leader is King David. King David. And you might say, oh, he's a great leader, but what I want you to think about is how he's an unexpected leader, how people didn't think he was going to be a leader. And you might think to yourself, wait, King David? He's awesome. He was a great king of Israel. He killed Goliath. He defeated him. He succeeded Saul. He acquired all this wealth to build the temple of God in the Old Testament. He was described as a man after God's own heart. He seems like he'd be a great leader. But if you traveled with a certain prophet named Samuel to a small town in Bethlehem, and you go to a man named Jesse, and he comes up to Jesse and he says, "One of your sons is going to be the next leader. Can you call them in here? I need to anoint the next king of Israel." All the sons gather. They all get in the room, and you can kind of picture them all lining up. And Samuel goes to the first son, and he looks at him, and that first son is thinking, "I'm the oldest. I'm the wisest. I should be the next king of Israel." And Samuel goes to him, and he says, "God has not chosen you." And then he goes to the next son, and he's probably the biggest and the strongest, and God goes to him and says, "I've not chosen you either." And down the line, he goes from son to son to son to son, all not the leader. And he goes to Jesse and he says, "Do you have any more sons? God has chosen one, but not any of these." And he says, "Well, there's one more. He's out in the field, tending to the sheep, but he's the youngest, he's the smallest. Are you sure you want him?" And David comes in, and Samuel looks at him and he says, "That's the one that God has chosen. He is going to be the leader." Someone who they did not expect at all to be the leader was the king. And he would go on to be a great king. The second person that I want to think about today is a person who came from the same town. We're still in Bethlehem, but this is 2,000 years later. And instead of at a family farm, we're in a barn and we're looking down at a manger box. And in there sits just a regular newborn baby. And he doesn't look special. He doesn't look royal, but it's a little newborn baby born to two common parents, Joseph, a carpenter, Mary, a common mother. And he doesn't look special. He doesn't get the royal treatment when he is born. No, he actually has to go to Egypt and run away. That doesn't seem very expected or kingly. He has to run away. And then he grows up in Nazareth, a town that's small, a town that's far away from the royal city of Jerusalem, a town that not many special people come from. But he grows up there, and then he becomes a preacher and a teacher, and he's very wise and he's very smart. And if you were a common person living in Israel, you heard about Jesus, you would probably think, "Yeah, he's smart, he's wise." But is he the Messiah? Is he God? No, probably not. He's just an ordinary guy. He isn't followed by Pharisees. He's not followed by religious teachers. No, he's followed by 12 disciples who are fishermen, tax collectors, and a couple brothers. Nobody special, nobody extraordinary. But when you look at Jesus and you think he doesn't look all that special, he doesn't look all that extraordinary, here's a hint. That was kind of the point. Our lesson today comes from Philippians chapter 2, verses 7 to 9, and it says, "But he emptied himself by taking the very nature of a servant when he was born in human likeness, and his appearance was like that of any other man, because he humbled himself and became obedient to death, became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name." See, Jesus, when he came down from heaven to earth, his goal was not to be extraordinary in an earthly sense. He humbled himself and looked like an ordinary person, like any other man. But Jesus isn't just any other man. Just like King David would go on to do great things, Jesus came on to do even greater things. And this week, I'm so happy to be here this week, because this is the week when he does his greatest things. And there's three things that I want you to think about that show that Jesus is not an ordinary man. First was Sunday. Does anyone remember what Sunday was? What did you celebrate on Sunday? Yeah. Yeah, Palm Sunday, right? Jesus rode into Jerusalem, that city of David, and he had chants of Hosanna. He had chants of the Savior. Everyone was happy to see him, and he looked extraordinary. But then event number two of the week, Maundy Thursday and Good Friday, he doesn't look too extraordinary. He prays in the Garden of Gethsemane. He gets arrested, and he goes to the cross. And there he suffers and dies for the sins of the entire world. And he looks like an ordinary man up on the cross. He looks like a regular guy dying, but his death is not just a regular death. No, his death won salvation for everyone. It defeated death, the devil, and the world, and announced that you are saved, all your sins are forgiven. His death was not ordinary. And then the third thing, it's coming on Sunday. Does anyone know what Sunday is? Yeah. Yeah, Easter, the best day of them all, right? Easter is coming when he will rise from the dead. He will announce that he has defeated death and that we too will defeat death and be with him in heaven one day. Jesus looked like an ordinary man, but he did extraordinary things. So the last thing I want you to think about here for this chapel is, do you ever feel ordinary? Do you ever look at your life and you say, I can't do what Jesus did. I can't be as great as King David. I can't do the things that those guys did because I'm just me. I don't have those skills and abilities. I don't have that position or the opportunities in my life to be like that. But what I want you to think about is that both of those men, while they were great, and the Bible recorded their greatness, they started as servants. They started as serving others. We talked about it at the beginning of the chapel. How can you serve others? That's a place to start. A verse that I like to think about sometimes when I'm wondering, what should I do? How can I be great like them? Is this one. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understandings. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your paths straight. Sometimes I like to think I'm talented, but I know that my talent, it's going to fail sometimes. Our skills are not as great as Jesus, but that's not what we're relying on, right? It says, lean not on your own abilities or your own understanding and your own skills. No, we look at Jesus, the best leader of them all, and we know that he has won us salvation, and with that, we get to do what he did, tell others. We get to do what he did, serve others. And as we go through this Holy Week and focus on Jesus after Holy Week, it's awesome because we get to keep doing that. We get to keep serving others. We get to keep telling others. And that's what we get to carry on from this chapel into our daily lives. Awesome. Amen. Next, we are going to collect our offerings that are going to MLC this quarter, which I'll talk about a little bit after. But I believe they are collected in the back. And our next song is going to be hymn 810, first song of Isaiah.
Thank you.
Awesome. Please stand. We pray. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. Keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings in life may please you. Into your hands I commend my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen. Awesome. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus make us strong to do his will. And may the peace of the Lord Jesus fill our lives. Amen. We're going to sing our closing hymn. You may be seated. Awesome. Good morning once again. I do not know if there are any announcements. Taking a quick scan of the room, seeing if Mr. Rank is coming forward.
Track people just meet right outside the gym doors after school. Okay? Thank you.
Awesome. You guys are starting track. That's such a fun thing. We got one more small presentation, because if you saw during the service, our fourth quarter mission is going to MLC, and so I've actually been invited here to talk a little bit about what that is going to be about, what those dollars, like your mission offerings, are going to do at MLC. And so while we are getting a couple more slides set up, I got a quick question for you guys today. Are you guys ready for a super fun day at school? I'm seeing some like, yeah, kind of some like, I'm ready. Up here, this group seems, they're ready. They're ready for Wednesday, man. It's time to go. The group back there, I don't know. Feels more like a Monday than a Wednesday. I'm not sure if you're ready to go. Oh, man. Are you at least excited that it's Holy Week? Good Friday? Easter Sunday? Do you guys have school on Monday? No? You get to celebrate Easter with an extra day off of school? Yes. That's awesome. That's what celebrating Easter is like, right? What you're going to do on that Monday is go and tell everyone, right? That's all you're going to dedicate Monday to, is just going to different people, different houses. Hey, did you hear it was Easter yesterday? Oh, you're going to sleep in probably, aren't you?
Yeah.
Probably going to sleep in. That's okay. Thank you.
twist, 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 twist. And you go the other way.
Awesome. Those in here, you can take your seats. Awesome. We're going to start in 3, 2, 1. Awesome. The reason that I'm here, obviously I love Giving Chapel, but Mr. Wilson asked me if I would come and talk to you guys about MLC, specifically because you guys are donating your fourth quarter missions to MLC, and it's an awesome thing. I'm a recent grad of MLC, so I kind of have some knowledge about what MLC is like, and I'm happy to share that with you guys here today. So what I'm going to talk to you about is MLC, and where I want to start with MLC, because MLC is a college just like Eastside that every day you get a taste of God's word, right? You guys get a taste of God's word every day here, and it's awesome. It's a blessing. And so MLC trains teachers and gives them a taste of God's word every day, and this is a passage that I thought was pretty cool. It says, train a child in the way that they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it. I think this passage is important because it talks about the goal of MLC. It's to train people to train others, right? MLC is there to teach pastors and teachers how to be good pastors and teachers so that we can train schools like you guys, all of you wonderful children. It's awesome. Other schools throughout Wisconsin, the Midwest, even in other countries around the world, MLC trains people so that they can go out and train others so that when they are old, they will not turn from God's word. But what we want to talk about is the college today. So let me give you a couple pictures. I'm going to tell you my story of MLC in just a couple pictures, okay? Some might be funny, so keep your laughs to a minimum. Don't laugh at me too hard. It's okay. Okay, so I'm going to share with you a couple pictures. First is at MLC, one thing that I got into that I did was choirs. This is my group of friends. We all were in different choirs. You can tell because we all have different colored robes on. Don't ask me which one was the best choir and which one was the worst choir, because you kind of see that one of us is in blue, and the blue is not very good, but that's okay. We all got to be in awesome choirs, and we got to sing songs in chapel like you guys did today, fifth and sixth grade. It's so fun. Another thing that I got to be in was plays, productions. I got to be in two of them. This one was Peter Pan, so I am in children's theater. It happens in the spring. I was in two productions. It's really cool because we get to invite 5,000 grade school kids come and watch us over a couple days, and so I was in two of those. It was really fun. MLC has a lot of different productions too. They have fun events like an outdoor party where we get to eat pie. You can tell I'm really good at eating pie because none of it got on my face at all. Now, they have fun events like this. This one is called Swine Sizzler. Basically, it's a big barbecue outside, and everyone on the campus gets to get together. You get to talk to each other. You get to encourage one another, and you get to have fun events like pie eating contest. There was a tug of war event that I was in that we won. And then so many other things are kind of fun about MLC. There's a lot of different sports. I didn't play the traditional basketball, baseball, or football. No, I did Ultimate Frisbee. And I was on an Ultimate Frisbee team that we actually played in a couple tournaments and played other colleges. It was really fun. And MLC offers quite a few opportunities to grow in athletics as well. They offer you a couple opportunities to go on what they call daylight trips. And these are two that I got to go on. What a daylight trip is they send teams of people to different spots around the country, different churches, and they help with church work that is needed. So on the left was a trip that I took when I was a sophomore. We went to Tennessee to a small church that was so small that they met in the living room of the pastor's house, and they just had church in the living room. There was enough people that you could all fit in the living room around the coffee table. And so we helped because they were setting up a booth at a marathon, and we did some canvassing to kind of spread the word. On the left was a church down in Panama City Beach, Florida, right after, I forget the name of the hurricane, but a hurricane hit junior year 2019, and the church was completely destroyed. And so we went down there and helped rebuild it. That's kind of why you see the church right now, kind of behind us, doesn't have any pews or paintings or a cross. We were re-mudding the whole place. We were putting up the drywall. We were building the church so that they could have church again. So MLC offers awesome opportunities to share your faith, to help other congregations grow. MLC is where you meet some fantastic people, like this is my wife who I met there, Erin. She, unfortunately, is teaching today. She couldn't make the trip with me, but that's okay. You get to meet awesome people there. And I graduated, and if you're wondering, why are you on a trampoline? It's because I graduated in 2020, and we were all home during the pandemic at that time, and so I never got to graduate at MLC. I graduated at my house. And so what do you do when you graduate at your house? You take pictures on the trampoline in your cap and gown to make it look like you're super cool. So MLC offers a lot of cool opportunities to grow in your faith, to share that faith, to do fun things like plays, sports. And what you guys are going to produce are train people to make awesome posters like this. Now, I had to embarrass Carter a little bit because I hadn't embarrassed him enough already. This is a project that they taught me how to do, and I just wanted to include it because at MLC, they teach you how to be a good teacher. And all good teachers know how to make a good poster because posters are vital. If you can make a good poster, you can make a good teacher. So here's my poster that I trained, how to shoot a basketball. And I used Carter when he was probably in first grade as the example poster. So I got some pictures up there. What MLC is there to do is train people how to be good teachers, pastors, and sharers of the gospel. So little couple facts about MLC so that you know. There are 666 students currently on campus. Campus is not that big, but they all stay in dorms that live on campus, and then they travel to all their different classes throughout, and the building that you see right there is the chapel. Now, this is a pretty cool chapel. You guys are blessed to have this awesome building to worship in every week, every Sunday, but at MLC, they have a whole building dedicated to it. It's not even attached to any classrooms. Everyone goes there, we get to see the inside of the chapel, and it's super cool, and everyone comes together, and we worship twice a day. Morning and evening chapel. Students are not just from Wisconsin. They're not just from Minnesota. They actually come from 33 different states around the United States, and they come from 8 different countries as well. And it's really cool to see all the people that want to be trained to share the gospel with others. They come from many different places. This guy's name is Kostia. I worked with him in the cafeteria when I had a job there. He's a really good guy. But he's from Croatia. He grew up in Croatia. He spent 1 year at Luther Prep, and then he decided he was going to be a pastor, and he came to MLC. And he's a super nice guy, and all these different people come from around the world because they see the value in sharing the gospel. And so you get people like Kostia who come from other countries who train to be pastors in congregations like he said. There are 487 people training currently to be teachers or staff ministers to help with church work. And here's what you guys are serving today. MLC is an awesome college, but what I've been told your mission offerings are going to is equipping Christian witnesses. This is a new program that MLC has created and is running to help better train the teachers and pastors that are on campus. And it comes in three aspects. One is student recruitment. What recruitment is going around and talking to people and seeing if they're interested in MLC. So if I asked you the question now, don't worry, I won't hold you to this in the future. But how many of you at one point in your life have ever thought, maybe I could be a teacher? I'll say I did it because I'm currently a teacher, so I did think about that thought. How many thought, oh, maybe I could be a pastor, maybe one day. You know, I'd like to be like Pastor Berg, Pastor Schlicht. That'd be pretty cool. Okay, a couple of you. What they're doing is they're trying to grow the congregation, trying to grow the school so that more pastors and teachers can come out of there, serve more congregations. There's some student financial aid, which is what a lot of your missions are going to go to, helping students pay for college so they can be pastors and teachers, and some cool student facilities that I'll show you in a minute. So student recruitment, what they are working on doing is going around to many more high schools like Lakeside, like Luther Prep. Sorry, I'm partial to Lakeside because that's where I went, but don't worry, I'll say Luther Prep because they exist too, and they're a pretty good high school as well. They go around to high schools like that and they say, have you ever thought about being a pastor or a teacher? And they say, you would be a really good pastor or teacher. You should think about it. And so they're going around seeing, would more people like to do that? Do you think you could come to MLC? And then they offer them some financial aid. And they say, MLC costs a lot of money. But don't worry. Congregations like Eastside, your fourth quarter missions, will help say, but we got some help. We can help you pay for that school. We can help you pay that bill so that you can become a pastor or a teacher. You can be happy, like those people in the graduation photo, like me on the trampoline, right? And then their last thing is that they're building some cool new facilities. When I went there, I lived in two dormitories. I lived in what was called Concord, where all the freshmen and sophomore guys live, and I lived in Summit my junior and senior year. And they were really cool buildings, but they were built, especially Summit, was built before World War I. That's a really old building. A building that was built before World War I, that means it's probably over 100 years old right now. What MLC is looking to do is build a new place for students to live. This is going to be called Luther Heights. And Luther Heights is going to be a new dormitory where people can live and students can have a cool room, can have a place to stay while they go to classes while they live in New Ulm, because New Ulm tends to get a little cold. Okay, it gets cold here too, but New Ulm gets really cold. So you need a good room that has heat, space for you to do your homework. And they're also building this new Betty Cron Fieldhouse because, like I shared, I was on MLC's Ultimate Frisbee team. We played Frisbee. But we didn't really have a space to practice or play. There were a couple days where we just played in the parking lot. And let me tell you, playing Ultimate Frisbee on a parking lot, not great. If you fall, it's gonna hurt. So they're building this new facility where people can practice, can play sports teams like football, baseball, softball, track. They all get to work out. They get to practice on a nice indoor facility. They get to play in this new place and they get to build their strengths. But if you're not a sports person, that's okay. How many of you play an instrument or like music? Quite a few. Awesome. MLC has a really cool, what they call wind symphony band. They have a lot of other bands too. They have praise band, they have worship band, they have wind symphony. They have a lot of different opportunities to play your instruments, to serve for chapel, and to go around and perform on concerts. So if you like music, MLC has a really cool selection of things that you can do with your musical abilities. I was not musically gifted. I don't think I could play a piano if I even tried, but that's okay. MLC offers that for people who love music. You get to serve on concerts, you get to go around touring, praising God with those wonderful gifts and abilities that he has given you. And then one last thing, I got a little cut off, that's okay, is your fourth quarter missions are gonna also go towards supporting their new early childhood center, because early childhood is a very important time, right? Good early childhood teachers are awesome, like the ones that you guys have here. It's really important to have good early childhood teachers, so your dollars are gonna go, or your mission offerings are gonna go to helping create a cool place where teachers can learn to work with little ones. Little guys, threes, fours, even newborns are at the early childhood center. And so making sure that that facility is updated is really cool because it allows them to practice so that when they come to congregations like Eastside, they know what they're doing. They're ready to go and they can serve you in the best possible way. MLC is really cool because it offers daily worship like we're doing right now in their really cool chapel. What I thought was a really cool aspect of MLC is that, how many of you like coming to chapel? Like, this is a cool time of the week. Look at how many people are raising their hands. Awesome. Eighth grade is just raising it because they're like, I don't have to do a class. I know how eighth graders think. I teach them. I know how you think, right? Chapel is a really cool opportunity. MLC daily, twice a day and on Monday three times a day because of comp line. Everyone gathers and they get a chance to worship together, and it's a really cool blessing. For everyone to come together, you can see how many people are there. You guys have a lot of students here that get to come together and your songs sound really good. Let me tell you, they sound even better when you got that many people singing the songs. When you got that many people up there doing the responsive readings, when you got that many people up there worshiping together, it's a really cool thing. And so your mission offerings are going towards a really cool project that produces good teachers and pastors that go out and serve in congregations, because MLC's mission is to train a core of Christian witnesses, like the teachers that you have here, like the pastors that you have here. MLC's goal is to produce good pastors and teachers that will serve in our Wells schools. So MLC, it's a really cool project. MLC thanks you that you chose to do this for your fourth quarter. They are super happy to support you in whatever you need, including, and I am shamelessly making this promotion because as a graduate of MLC, this is coming up, and they asked that I would put this in my slides. Oh, MLC Day. It's coming up. Teachers, in case you forgot, it's May 4th. It's coming up quick. It's already April 13th. That means it's less than a month away. Don't forget, MLC Day is coming up. MLC is happy to support you guys in many different ways. Just reach out to them, and they're so happy to do things like this chapel, to do things that support you, because you are doing an awesome job of supporting them. And it's such a cool thing that we're working together in ministry. That is all the slides that I have. I think I have like 2 minutes. If anyone's got a quick question. Oh, there's the bell. Okay, 2 minutes starts now. You only have 2 minutes. Go. Yeah.
My birthday is actually a 19th.
Really? That's so cool. Any other questions quick that you have of MLC? Yeah. Ultimate Frisbee. Oh, man. Ultimate Frisbee is the greatest. It's like taking football and Frisbee and combining it. Your goal is to score touchdowns with the Frisbee. Now, you can't tackle people, but you toss it back and forth, and you try to work the Frisbee down the field to score a touchdown. It's so much fun. Yeah. What is MLC Day? That's a great question. MLC Day is the day when you come in and you wear red, white, or black, and that works out great because that's Eastside's colors, right? So you can wear red, white, or black on MLC Day. And what a lot of schools do is they send a picture to MLC that says, we love MLC. We're happy to support MLC. We are giving our fourth quarter missions to MLC. And MLC will put all of those wonderful photos into a cool video, and they will send it out, and they will say, look at all the cool schools, all the cool kids, all the cool teachers that support MLC. So it's kind of a day where you wear red, white, and black to support this school. Yeah. No, it's not an official holiday. I wish it was. It's not an official holiday, unfortunately. You will still have to come to school. But that's okay. Okay, I got time for one more. Last question. And I see none. That's okay. Okay. Well, thank you guys for letting me come here. It's super cool to talk to you guys, lead you guys in chapel. I hope you have a blessed Wednesday and a happy Holy Week. I hope you make time to go to church on Sunday for Easter. Blessings on the rest of your day.